Yes. Okay. Yeah. Sorry. It's okay. That's gonna be a problem, I think, for my next lectures. Okay. So what I was saying is that I wanted to stress a bit the Alberti-Marchese theorem, and so that's so I'm gonna give you a very imprecise and short summary of this beautiful paper. So on the differentiability of Lipschitz function with respect to measures in the Euclidean space. So, and the key point of this paper and this theory is that once you have a measure sigma, so sigma is a positive Radon measure, say, you can associate to sigma what is called a decomposability bundle. Which in a sense is a set, is a, let me write this name. So, mu sigma is a map from say, is a, okay. There are some measurability issue which I don't want to deal with. So mu sigma is a Grassmannian value sigma measurable map. So meaning that it's a measure is a sigma measurable map. So it's a measurable map with the property that for each x you have u sigma of x, which is a say kx, so dimensional subspace. Maybe k is the order of my operator, so let's call it L. X dimensional subspace of RD. So in each point X, I mean at sigma all point X, X, you can find a vector space view sigma of x. Okay, so this should be thought as a generalization of a tangent plane to a classical surface in a sense, and the key property of this view sigma is the following. So with the property that so let's go to this theorem. So first of all, every Lipschitz function is differentiable sigma almost at sigma almost of x in the directions of u sigma x, and so this means that for sigma all x there exists a linear map dv sigma x. So I mean this means that for so this means that given a Lipschitz function f Lipschitz for sigma almost all x there exists a linear map which goes from u sigma x into say R such that you're gonna write h equal f of x plus dv right h plus little o of h for all h which are in this direction, in this k-dimensional subspace. So basically, you can differentiate the Lipschitz function in the tangent in well, tangent direction, in the direction of this decomposability bundle, which in the case, for instance, of a k-dimensional surface, it would be the tangent plane. And second thing is that this result is optimal. So optimal. In the sense that there exists a Lipschitz function such that for sigma almost all x and every vector v which does not belong in the space the derivative of f in the direction of v does not exist. So this is the key theorem. So basically, for each measure, you can find the maximal a subspace, which is somehow is the maximal one, along which every Lipschitz function is differentiable in that in the direction of that subspace. Okay. So my example is before you, if you have a, like a curve into R2, this decomposability bundle will be just the tangent bundle somehow. But then again, here the dimension can change point by point because you can imagine you have a curve and then also a two-dimensional surface. So a measure associated with a curve and with the two-dimensional surface into R3, say, and now the decomposability bundle will be the tangent bundle on this on the curve, which is a one-dimensional, and the tangent bundle on the surface, which is two-dimensional. And you can imagine that you can build up more and more complicated examples. For instance, you can have a superposition of curves, right? I mean, a union of curves, and you can also think that any convex combination of these curves will still give you a one-dimensional decomposability bundle, or at least a one-dimensional decomposability bundle. Okay, so they were able to identify this subspace, but not only, they were able to characterize this subspace in terms of measures. So they were speaking about currents. I don't want to speak about currents here, but so that's completely equivalent to satisfying with to characterize these things with respect to measure, which are satisfying a differential constraint. So the second theorem still due to Alberti Marchese is the following. Let me see how can I write it. Okay, let me write it in the so given again it's a bit loose statement, but maybe it's a more clear one. Sigma the following are equivalent. The first one is that there exists, well, let me start with the easiest one. The first one is, oops. The dimension of the decomposability bundle mu sigma x is at least L for sigma all x. So you have the decomposability bundle is at least L dimensional, whatever L is. The second one is that there exists mu 1 mu d RD valued. Same UL, sorry, RD valued measures such that for first the divergence of these measures are zero. Second, my original measure sigma is absolutely continuous with respect to each one of these one. or I. And third, if you look to the derivative of d mu I with respect to d mu, so this exists mu I almost everywhere. So since sigma is smaller, in a sense, is smaller than our measure, so I can do this, these differentials at sigma all points, right? So this family of vectors is well defined for sigma all x. And then I look to the span, and this is, well, in a sense, it should be the bundle. So in particular, they are linearly independent since this thing is dimension. Well, let me, so the dimension of this span, no, well, these are less. So the dimension of this span is L. And this is actually, I mean, it's a subspace of the bundle. Okay, so the fact that the dimension of the span is at least L, say L, exactly L, it means that in a sense, you can find L independent measures, divergence-free measures with respect to which your function is, with respect to which your measure is absolutely continuous, okay? So this, so the geometric interpretation is the following. So to get the geometric insight on this,
Maybe a quick question.
Yes.
This L is independent of X, or could it be a different L for every X?
Well, no, the way I'm stating it is like it's L independent from X, for X, from X, yes. So the point is, I mean, you can make states which are X dependent, but they're going to be maybe a bit more complicated, so I didn't want to. So, but because of the application. So in a sense, to be sure that the dimension is L, oops. To be sure that the dimension is L, you want to find, in a sense, L, L independent vector fields. And the point is that these L independent, so the fact that this exists is sort of by definition of having dimension L. But the point is that you can somehow glue all these things together in such a way that you don't create divergence. That's the key point. So it's a sort of local frame of divergence-free vector fields. So your question is, can I get a global frame? I think so, yes. But it was a bit more, yeah. So I think I can get in a sense of global frame of divergence-free vector fields or sort of that. I mean, in a sense, you globally, so the dimension is discrete, right? So you can decompose your measure into pieces which the dimension is exactly L. You build these things for each of these pieces, and then you put them together. You just have to be careful that they don't mess up too much one with the other, but you should be able to do that. So but in this way, it's more convenient. In a sense, almost all the statements we are going to do, they can be localized enough so that you can really imagine that this dimension is constant. Is this answering?
Yes, thanks.
Okay. So to get the geometric intuition, let's look to this. So there is a theorem which is due to Smirnov, which is saying essentially this is following. Again, these things are slightly loosely stated. So let's mu, if I take a vector valid measure from RD to RD, is divergence free if and only if there exists a measure, let's call lambda, a probability measure on loops such that mu is the integral. So maybe let me write these things and then. And then comment. So, okay, imagine that you have a loop. Okay, so a loop is just a smooth, well, it's a closed curve. I don't want to enter into smoothness because otherwise most of the thing I'm gonna say are gonna be false. So it's a closed, say, C1 curve, and in each point you have a tangent direction. Now to mu, to this gamma, you can associate a vector valued measure mu gamma, which whose action of a function phi is just the integral of phi in the point gamma dot. So this is a vector valued. So phi is a vector valued function again. Say C is a continuous function values in RD. So it's phi dot gamma against the gamma dots. Okay. So this is a scalar product, and you. And you integrate this thing. So if gamma is parameterized by a map, you can get you're gonna get this this function. So this is this measure. So basically, the measure is just a measure associated with the curve, with as a tangent, where is the direction? It has the tangent direction to the curve. Okay. So now, if you want to compute what is the divergence of mu applied to some function, say f, this is nothing but by duality, this is mu applied to gradient f. Which is the integral of gradient f gamma dot over S1, which is just zero because this is a total derivative, right? So this is would be the integral over S1 of the total derivative of f composed with gamma. And this is gonna be zero. So this is a classical divergence free. So somehow the vector field associated with a closed loop is a divergence free measures. And what Smirnov theorem is telling you is that every divergence free measure is given by this. Okay, it's given by a superposition of this elementary vector fields. This is sort of cheating. So there are another class of vector fields, which another class of things which should be considered, which are not of this really of this type, but I won't deal with that because up to something which most of the time you can deal with, what you get is this. So you have a superposition of closed curves, okay? And so you should think as to a divergence free vector field as like a superposition of curves. And the other good thing is that somehow when you want to compute what is the mu with, so the direction at the point x, well, this is the direction of the unique curve passing through there somehow. Well, okay, you should think that. Still, maybe we can should put this in quotation mark because it's not completely true the way I'm saying, but you can imagine that, so if your measure is a superposition of these curves, well, then when you want to compute the polar, well, this is the direction of the curve passing through there. If there are more curves, you just should average these directions, okay? But the point is that, it's included in this, let me write this again very loosely. This is true without cancellations. So what do I mean by this? So without cancellation means basically the following. Means that if you look to the measure, to the actual mass measure of mu, well, this is the sum of the mass measures of my mu gammas. So this means that somehow there is no, you see, if you have two curves which pass through a point, when you average them, you get the vector is gonna be shorter, right? So this equality here wouldn't be true unless basically what is happening is that for most points, you just have one curve passing through those points. So that's why when I write these things and saying the unique curve passing through that point means that at almost all points, you can imagine that there is really one curve passing through that point, okay? So now that you think to this as as a superposition of curves, the intuition of this statement here is basically that if the dimension of your bundle is, say, L, well, you can find L independent family of curves such that sigma can be written, or actually is absolutely continuous with respect to, as a superposition of the measures associated to this curve. This is, again, not so true, but if we go back to our example of a two-dimensional surface, well, you see here that it, this can be decomposed somehow as the sum of measure on curves when curves points in this direction or when curves points in this other direction. So you have two family of curves which are somehow giving you this measure. So this, so sigma can be written in a sense as an integral of horizontal curves, so the measure associated to H2 restricted to sigma can be written as an integral of horizontal curves and at the same time as an integral of vertical curves. Okay, so so you see that, and the tangent to these curves is indeed spanning. So if you look to the span of the two, of the tangent vector to the family of red and black curves, this is one vector, and this is the other one. Well, they are spanning the tangent plane at almost all points, right? So in a sense, the fact that the decomposability bundle is called as dimension L, it means that you can decompose indeed your measure as a sum of, you have L different decomposition of your measure as sum of one dimensional measures. Where by sum, I mean integral against the suitable probability measure onto L dimensional measures, okay? And the key point is that again, this, so you can do this in a way that is not adding any divergence to these measures. And there are no cancellations in a sense. So, and the theorem of Andrea Giovanni is telling you that again, this is a lot related to the existence or not of, I mean, the validity or not of Rademacher theorem with respect to that measure. And in particular, in a sense, you can always differentiate measures along this tangent, differentiate Lipschitz function along these tangent directions, and you cannot do it along the orthogonal directions to this bundle, okay? And yeah, so the structure should somehow resemble, so the structure of a measure with a k-dimensional, L-dimensional verifiability bundle should somehow resemble the one of an L-dimensional surface, that would be the intuition. So, but we're gonna see that this is not so true. So let me write this way in here. Okay, measures, so we measure sigma for which bundle as dimension L should look like yeah. L dimension surface. So this is false by this following example. So take C as a subset of say 0, 1. So counter set, so let's say S dimensional counter set, whatever it is. And now to take the measure, sigma to be HS restricted to C times H1 restricted to 0, 1, okay? So what is happening here is that in R2, I'm taking for each, I put C say on the y-axis, and for each copy of C, I take an interval 0. So for each point of C, I'm taking the interval 0, 1. Okay, so the what you can prove is that the dimension of sigma is equal to 1. On the other end, the Hausdorff dimension of sigma is large. So this is larger, I think. Okay, I think it's 1 plus s, right, in this case, which is strictly larger than 1. So it's not really, and it's actually strictly less than 2. So in a sense, you can still have fractal measures for which the composability bundle is non-trivial dimension. And in a sense, you see, because you always have a direction in which things are good, because in this direction, you look like a one-dimensional measure, but in the orthogonal direction, you're sort of bad, okay? So that's what is happening here. So this intuition is not completely correct. Would be, but this is then would become false, that you are like a sum of L-dimensional things. So this is gonna be too much to ask for. But so if you go and look to this example, you see that basically this example has always dimension larger or equal than the one you expect, right? So if the composability bundle has dimension 1 in this case, well, your measure is actually dimension larger than 1. And to make an example like this, I cannot make it in dimension 1 unless really I'm like a countable union of curves, essentially, right? So so the theorem.
Can I ask a question before you continue?
Sure.
Is it correct to say that Rademacher's theorem does not see fractal dimensions?
Yes, so at the very end, so let me, yeah, I'm gonna say the two theorems now. And
okay.
So I mean, as a consequence of this thing, in a sense, yes. So Rademacher theorem actually doesn't see anything except full dimensional measures.
Okay.
So the only possibility for a measure to have Rademacher theorem is that this measure is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure. And not only in a sense, if you are at the Rademacher theorem along L dimensions, you should be at least L dimensional. And if you are really L dimensional, you are a surface. That's what I'm gonna state.
Okay.
Thank you. Thanks. Okay, so the theorem, which is basically is the combination of my work with Philip, there is Alberti Marchese, that's the theory has been built, plus the work with myself with Philip, and then a SQL paper with Arroyo Rabaza, myself, Jonas Hirsch, and Philip again, which is the following. So I mean, this is the consequence of this theory is that, so let sigma be a positive measure. For which the dimension of the composability bundle of sigma is equal to L, then first, sigma is absolutely continuous with respect to L dimensional out of measures. Okay, so you cannot see any set of smaller dimension. Okay, so this in particular tells you that the dimension of sigma is at least L. Actually, slightly more is true. What you can prove is that sigma is absolutely continuous with respect to the integral geometric measure of dimension L, which you can forget what it is for a moment if you don't know. So that if you look sigma and you restrict it to its actual L dimensional part, so which should be the point where, let me write this thing, sigma L is, okay, the way I'm writing it, I think I want it to be positive, is L rectifiable. Meaning that it's a countable union. Of again, I'm being a bit loose here, but L dimensional surfaces. Okay, so and here this density here, theta star L sigma x, is just you look to the measure of the ball of radius r centered in x. You expect this measure to be at least L dimensional, so you expect this thing to go to zero slower than r to the L. Sorry, faster, go to zero faster, to be below r to the L. So if you divide by r to the L, in the point in where you expect this to be really L dimensional, you expect this limit to be somehow, I mean, asymptotically, this thing to be positive. So after you take the limit loop, so this is the weakest thing you can do. And this is the definition. So you, here you want this thing to be positive. It somehow means that these things shouldn't be shouldn't go to zero faster than r to the L. Okay. On the one from the first one, you know that it doesn't go to zero. So actually, in a sense, this should be finite. Because for the first one, you can prove that it implies that these things doesn't go to zero slower than r to the L. So this quantity, so one implies that theta star L is finite. Nobody ensures you that these things is positive. So for instance, sigma could be like the Lebesgue measure. So these things would go like r to the n, r to the d, this is L is less than d, so these things would go to zero. But if I really look to the smallest possible dimension, so then on that part, I look like a superposition of L-dimensional things, a countable union of L-dimensional things, right? So if you think to this example, you see here, when you look to this, this sigma will always be somehow zero, because the measure of a ball here should go like r to the 1 plus s. If I divide it by r, this is gonna go to zero. Okay. But you see, it's always larger than one, the exponent. So it's always finite, that thing. It's just non-zero. So a corollary, I mean, of this theory, although, okay, here I'm cheating because basically we first proved the corollary in the theorem, but is that Rademacher theorem, so if Rademacher theorem holds for sigma, then I mean, from one, sigma is absolutely continuous with respect to the d dimensional measure. So, I mean, if Rademacher theorem holds for sigma, then the dimension of u sigma should be d, because I need to differentiate in all directions, right? So, the decomposability bound should be full dimensional. So, from one, V sigma is absolutely continuous with respect to HD, which is nothing but, it's not V sigma, sorry, sigma, which is nothing but LD. So Rademacher, so this is called the converse of Rademacher theorem because it tells you somehow that the Rademacher theorem can hold only for a measure, can hold only for measures which are absolutely continuous with respect to the back measure. Okay.